Welcome to the It's Time to Sell podcast with your host, Chris Spurvey. Chris is dedicated to mentoring entrepreneurs and sales professionals through the fear of selling so they can confidently bring their product or service to market. Here's your host, Chris Spurvey.
Lisa, welcome to the It's Time to Sell podcast. Grateful for you joining me.
Thank you, Chris. Great to be here.
Yeah, it's great to talk to a fellow Atlantic Canadian who's out there making it happen. And we got similar backgrounds as we talked about on the phone. So why don't we just jump on in? I'd love for you to tell the audience who you are and what you're up to today.
All right. Sounds great. I am, by experience, a corporate professional who spent about 30 years working in various corporations. My mandates have always been about growth, working with teams, working with clients, and always had a big part of change. One of the elements that has been in the work that I do from very early days is coaching. I adopted a coaching style of leadership very early on in my banking career. And it served me well in helping my teams be successful and ultimately me be successful. And over time, I've evolved that, became very focused on it. A couple of years ago, I went and got my certified executive coaching, and that was a turning point for me. I became very passionate about the potential and the results that executive coaching can offer corporations for getting to the financial results and the success that they want. So I did something bold and decided to follow my purpose and passion, and I left corporate and launched my own business. So started Pivotal Coaching with the focus on being very intentional in the services offered in two areas, leadership and revenue. Working with some amazing corporations who are, from their perspective, they want to grow, they want to see more revenue results, and they're looking for different ways to get their teams into learning and development. Training fits a certain place, but there are some high-performing professionals. Sales is where a lot of high-performing professionals are. They're looking for something different. So again, that's where I'm focused and working. From a personal perspective, if starting a business wasn't enough, my husband and I decided to sell our family home. Our daughters are grown and independent and doing well, and we decided to make a change. So I described we half-sized. Which was a lot of work, but we did it, and now we're living close by downtown Halifax and loving the lifestyle, having a lot of fun. So a lot of effort, but the change has been a lot of fun and been very supportive for business as well. So that's my story. So here we are.
Yeah, that's outstanding. There's so many correlations between your story and my story. I mean, coming from corporate type of thing and doing our own independent, I suppose, not solopreneur. I guess it is solopreneur. We're independent operators of a business, and we're helping business owners and leaders within organizations. I'm very curious because as I listen to you speak, I'm feeling an immense confidence coming from your voice. I'm curious if you go back in your career, how did that, was that always there or did it form over time? I'm just really curious about that.
That is a fabulous question. I would say I definitely had vulnerabilities in my confidence along my career. There were some very tough points in my career. I think one of the toughest and most vulnerable points was when I was in capital markets in 2008, 2009. So it always hasn't been there. I think that when I launched my business, my network, because I've been a relationship person and developed good relationships, it was really my network that have really given me that confidence. My first year of business, I was a little more opportunistic to what I was going to do and the focuses. And I followed the lead of my connections and relationships. And their feedback and their encouragement and their ongoing support has given me the confidence, and my clients that I work with that I do have something and that it is different. Yeah. So I think that outside of corporate, I stand stronger than I did inside of corporate. So the very astute question. Yeah.
Yeah, that's outstanding. Have you found that the certification, you call it the executive coach, is that what it's called?
Certified executive coach,
Has the process of achieving that brought some extra level of being able to stand up and wave your flag? I'm curious about that.
Absolutely. And the way I describe it is I started this program as what I thought was a very strong coach. And the program took me through what I call the messy middle. And at the end, there was definitely some strength. And as part of the certification, you had to take practice clients. So I worked with nine personal clients and one corporate client as part of my certification. And so my clients, you know, went through the whole journey from start to messy to end. And it was their feedback that really got you focused and understanding and appreciating what it was that mattered, because it was a very candid relationship. They knew when they were starting to work with you that it was a reciprocal, not just about the coaching, but they would give you feedback. Yeah. And so they were very candid in their feedback. So the certification was huge for me. And I know if you look at the coaching world, there's a very broad mix of those that are certified and not. Because of my own experience, I really do encourage people to get that certification. It does make an invaluable difference.
Yeah, that's outstanding. Yeah, I can see it. I mean, it makes a whole lot of sense to me. The process of going through becoming certified and the ability then that process obviously gives you a framework and gives you something to follow. And
there's a distinctive methodology that they teach you.
Yeah. So sales, you've mentioned sales quite a bit. I'm really curious. First thing that comes to mind is I'm curious about the sales effort that you put into your business ongoing. Has sales always been relatively easy for you, or do you, just what does sales look like for you today to attract clients?
Sales, I have always done big, complex B2B sales. So as you well know, they're long sales cycle. They take a fair amount of resiliency. They ebb and flow. So the deals that I've done have never been easy, but it's all I've known. So I was comfortable in big, complex sales cycle. In my own business, I think there's a couple things I would share. So while the sales process was comfortable, the market and taking my own brand to market has been harder. The aspect of coaching is people have very distinctive views on the impact of executive coaching in corporate world. So I have to overcome those perceptions. And one of my big focuses is around using coaching programs to support the results for corporations, which is a little different. Most times corporations have always sort of, it would be a one-to-one. So, let's say, for example, you would hire me to work with one of your team, and I'm really trying to get a program approach. So it's a different product that I'm taking to market. So that makes it a little harder. So I lean a lot on my relationships. So I have a good network. So that's been invaluable. Referrals are huge. And so the testaments of my work and the clients that have experienced my work are a big important part. And I also do cold calling. So that if I'm going to work with businesses and their leaders around, true growth, as you well know, building existing relationships is more comfortable. Selling new products, not too bad. But when you do, cold start to origination, that is a very distinctive style. So I do that as well, because I think it's good skills practice for both myself, but in the work that I provide my clients as well.
Yeah, it keeps you in the game, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I'm with you 100%. I find that challenging myself, because it's hard for me to challenge somebody if I'm not challenging myself or feeling challenged. So what does that cold call look like? Are you prospecting using, say, LinkedIn, and then from there finding out who the decision maker is and making a phone call? Is that what you're doing?
Yeah, so I work with a leads list. So I have a leads list. And I would say I'm a little more traditional. I mean, there's some people that use a lot of the digital marketing. And for me, in the big corporations that I am cold calling into, I still believe that, you've got to get in there on a personal basis. And I think part of that is I know that if I can get that conversation, that's going to be where the difference is made. So I do an email outreach, I do the phone call, I do the connection on LinkedIn. As you would well know, the success rate in working through a lead list is low.
Yeah.
Always hard in the ego, but there's been some good conversations that have come out of that. So you just got to try. You just don't know.
Yeah, absolutely. I had a prospect last week tell me to stop bugging him. It was the first time it had ever happened to me where he actually said,
"Yeah,
bugging me."
Yeah. But you know what? One of the things I keep saying to, so, you know, I love it when people are really candid, because, you know, the maybe place is really hard. And when people drag out the babies, you know, it takes your energy and your effort from other things. True. So, right. So I do love a direct.
Yes.
No, we're good. Yeah.
Yeah. So I love that reframing.
One of the things that, you know, especially because of my relationships, and I've been calling on relationship-based opportunities, some of my relationships don't want to say no to me. And they feel like they're going to hurt my feelings. And I've now gotten very direct and say, look, that, you know, please don't feel like you have to say yes or maybe with me. If it's a fit, great. Yeah. If not, that's okay. You know, it doesn't change our relationship. I get that, but don't feel you have to give me hope.
Yes, absolutely. One of the things that I've been consciously trying to focus on as best I can, and I just before we hit record, I expressed that the consulting side of my business has taken off, as yours has as well. Mm-hmm. And what that has done for me is I've taken a little bit of the eye off the ball around growing a brand, and such that I'm attracting opportunities to me. The other thing that I've taken my eye off of, and here I am publicly declaring it, is the system I take is systematization. Is that the right word?
Yeah.
So, you know, I had been doing quite strongly in building out courses and so on, but I've taken a little bit of the eye off the ball. So I've come back to that as of late and said, you know, I'm going to and this is a tidbit for maybe you, but definitely my audience. Every night before I go to bed for the last 3 weeks, I've been going through every conversation I've had with a client or a prospect throughout the day, and I'm just making bullet point notes of little pieces of that I've done that day that I can turn, maybe leverage it in some way to either develop a course, write an article, or so on. I'm curious about you. Are you planning to move down the path, or have you already went down the path of systematizing certain aspects of it?
So very early on, I learned about outsourcing. And so having come from corporate, I knew exactly what my strengths and weaknesses were, and I wasn't going to try and, build a business and learn PowerPoint skills and get my word editing skills up. So I leveraged outsourcing. I found some great partners. So that was step one. The other thing is that by experimentation with my clients, I've developed my own pivotal coaching methodology around my client work. So there is a very definite structure, and the way I describe it is both the traditional coaching conversation, but it also is exercises and learning and development, and the two run parallel, is where I help my clients get to results. So that means that the how you approach it and where they fall and the phases are very distinctive. Yeah. And for me, I do have a vision for scale, and that's so, you know, while today it is me and some subcontractors, I'd like to see where I can take the business. So I've recently just invested in process mapping.
Nice.
So that would mean that when I onboard clients, when I onboard subcontractor coaches, they know the process and flow. So that's just like in the last month that I've done that. So yeah. I'm exactly with you in sort of getting that foundation in place. And I had a little bit of time. I had a deal that I thought was going to close. It didn't close. So I then had capacity. So I took that time to go and focus on processing.
Yeah,
and
I
so I should say process.
Sounds like we're thinking down the same path. I mean, it is important, right? Because I mean, here I'm in my mid-40s now, and I'm looking at the future of my business and thinking somewhat about legacy, I guess, to some extent, right? And when I say legacy, I'm thinking about my family and the future of my family and so on. So, it'd be nice to have something that's leverageable, as I move forward. And it just makes common sense, is really.
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely. Yep.
So, we all have really important things in our lives, right? I mean, I'm really curious. What are the most important aspects? Most important things in your life right now?
Oh gosh, where are you? I'm big on family. Family. So, our daughters, extended family, aging parents. So that's always, when I'm not working, that's where all the time goes. From the professional point of view, I think the big philosophies for me and what really fuels me, it's about helping. And so how do I give back and help? So my businesses helps corporation. I'm active in the community. So my couple passions are around entrepreneurship. So I'm a mentor with Innova Corp. I do some individual mentoring. I'm doing Feed Nova Scotia. So right now sit on their board and also helping them with a large capital campaign. So that those are the themes. And I would say the shifts may be the actual focus of how I help may be as a typical entrepreneur. I may ebb and flow a little bit, but at the core, it all comes back is what can I do to help?
Yeah. How... The mentoring piece, that's interesting because I'm similar. I try to give back as best I can. I do find it sometimes entrepreneurs come in and out of my life or into my life. They stay in my life, of course. But the mentoring piece is interesting because obviously we our time is valuable, right? And we want to be giving back. How do you have any ideas as to how to draw the line between mentoring and paid opportunities?
Yeah, I think the mentoring is that the way they ask and what they're looking for. And so if it's, a specific expertise, that they want to achieve a result, then that starts to move into the professional world. If it's a peer colleague, someone with experience that they can just iterate with, then that would be more the mentoring. But I think I would say that for most of the mentoring, I've tended to exactly to your point, because I find that people are always looking for as much giving as they can. Yes. And for people like you and I, there do have to be some boundaries. So I appreciate the organized structures because they then act as the gatekeeper. So when Innova Corp has a structured mentoring program, they broker the structure. They have a methodology that they use for the way you work with the entrepreneurs. And I find that's helpful. But you're right, the how you figure out when it's a potential client and when it's a mentor is a definite conversation. And I would say that I've embraced much more candor in those conversations as of late, because for you and I, our time is our most valuable commodity. And in most cases, we're always running out of time. So when we give, we want to make sure that we're having a high impact, right? That we're really being able to do what we can do our best work at.
Absolutely. How has mentoring played a role in your growth? And maybe I'll express my thought on that. I've got a lot of mentors, but a lot of the mentors are people. They're not people I talk to on a regular basis, but they come in and out of my life. And it's like the mentorship almost happens inside my own brain, where I say to myself, I wonder what the jury would do in this case, as an example. Curious, do you have ongoing relationships with either a coach yourself or a mentor or multiple mentors?
From a coach perspective, I have paid coaches. I've got a very strong peer coach network, and I have a mentor coach that has been invaluable in my journey. And with respect to my business mentoring, I would say the honest answer is I've had a hard time finding that one person. And the way I've approached it, I had, one of a networking event, a breakfast. I sat beside a very successful CEO, and we just got chatting. And one of the questions I asked her, I said, so how do you get your mentoring based on where you are in your career? And she said, I use coffee mentoring. So she said, I have a group of my network that I respect and admire. And each of them has their own place of contribution for the work that I do. And they know that they're my coffee mentor. And when I reach out to them, and so she said that it's not structured in the sense of how often, but they'll sit down and have a coffee. And I think that really resonated with me. And for myself, I would use more of a coffee mentoring style. So there's a couple people, and that's worked well. I think I hear it from you too. There's still that wonderment if there should be a little bit more structure to that mentoring. But I haven't found that fit. Like when you really are vested in a long-term mentor relationship, that fit has to be well aligned, and I'm still looking for that mentor for the long term.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm with you 100%. I find, and I think I'm speaking to a very high growth individual as well, as our most guests I have on my show. I find personally, and it's not a ego thing, but it's I seemingly grow out of my mentor pretty quick. If that makes sense. That's Well, I don't know if that maybe that's more on certain coaches, like a marketing coach or you know, that type of thing. I find the event over a very quick period of time, I still almost become the teacher and my mentor becomes the student of that.
Well, I mean, but that goes reflection, I think, of sales professionals. I mean, one of the things that I've gotten really entrenched in is using performance psychology in the work that I've done. And so as part of that journey being certified, I've really start to appreciate high performing talent and what makes them high performing. So they consume information, they're fast learners, you know, the growth. And so, you know, to your point, they quickly outgrow those around them. So they're always, you know, raising the bar themselves.
You got it.
And that to me would be reflective of someone like you. So
yeah, no, absolutely. I think you're right. And I'm definitely, as you are, action taker. You consume the information and I'm still reading the last paragraph and I'm already implementing something.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. That doesn't mean I stick with it. I find I'm also, maybe the question for you is how do you make quick decisions in your business? And sort of, let's just say you go down a certain path and you start to get feedback that it's not really working quite the way you anticipated. Do you quickly make a decision to pivot around that?
Yeah. And that's, I think, one of the most liberating things of being an entrepreneur. For years, there was everyone else had an opinion and there was always that one or two in the group whose voice was mattered more. And now I can quickly react and respond. And I'll be honest, there are times that I choose not to listen because I've got a longer term view. And I think, you know, sometimes there's bigger pieces or I've always been strategic in my lens on it. And I think, okay, I've tucked that, I've hear that, I'm going to tuck that, but I want to push it a little bit more and see where this goes. So, so I can be, you know, I embrace a lot. I'm very open to feedback, but there are times you need to hear it, but maybe not react.
Yeah.
But for the most part, I do tend, I'd say it's very intuitive, right? Yeah. So, and I think that's what my experiences has led me to be much more comfortable is that I've got a really great base to use and leverage. So, you know, digest and react and move on. So
that's outstanding. It sounds like you're very centered around your business and life and so on. So you've alluded a couple of times to relationships being a very important aspect of your business. And obviously the growth of those relationships, you have to obviously meet people, which involves networking and getting out and shaking some hands and sharing stories and getting to know one another. Tell me, and I mean, obviously the word networking for many people, it brings up negative points of view. They're nervous in those situations. Tell us about your philosophy around networking.
So if you're not networking, it's opportunity lost. And there are, you know, it's who didn't you meet, who could have helped you. And if you're not open to new relationships, you know, what's the potential that you're missing.
Yeah.
And for me, it comes down to, and you also ascribe to this, it's mindset or attitude. What is your attitude about networking? And so interestingly, you know, we're both sales leaders, and there's a permeating attitude about sales. And I think there's also a permeating attitude about networking. And, you know, it is something that's unfortunate. And I think that, you know, people need to have the right attitude. They need to go in it into these networking opportunities with a clear sense of what they're going to get out of it. And oftentimes I hear people, oh, I'm just going to this networking. I'm just, you know, and I'm just, and so they just show up. And you can't just show up. You've got to have some intentionality. So for me, it's about, you know, how you see networking, how you show up to networking. And the other thing that is a big thing for me is that give and take of conversation.
Yeah.
So, you know, even if I reflect on my conversations with you, you're great at asking questions. You know, you're genuinely interested in, you know, the people that you talk to and about what I bring to the table. There are times I've been in conversations that person that I've been having a conversation with hasn't asked me a question. And that is not networking. That's not relationship building. That's not a good conversation. So, you know, it's how are you engaging? How are you having that connection with that person?
Yeah, I love it. It's interesting you say that. I remember our first ever conversation. I was driving between between the airport and Halifax to Moncton, I think it was,
yeah,
or St. John.
Yeah.
And somehow because I always do a little bit of, maybe this is a tip for people, I do a little bit of analysis when I hang up the phone from somebody, and I basically say, did I go into that conversation with the right intention, maybe as a question, but more importantly, did I approach that conversation and allow the other person to be heard? And it's what's interesting about our first ever dialogue. I found, and it might have been because I was half distracted, not distracted. I was on my way somewhere, and we only had a short period of time. For some reason, I hung up the phone, saying to myself, "You know what? I did that conversation. I didn't approach that conversation right. It was like I threw up all over you in a short period of time." It's interesting, right? Well, it's good to hear you perceived it maybe a little bit differently, but my analysis was a bit differently.
Yeah. Well, I think I would describe it. We had a rapid fire conversation. We I think in about 20, 25 minutes, we got in and covered topics that most conversations would take over an hour or two. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. So share with us the vision for, you know, your business and where you see it over the next 3 to 5 years. I'm curious about that, and I'm sure the people listening are curious.
Well, thanks for that opportunity. I think that, you know, the big thing is that most businesses are focused on growth. And over the last number of years, that people have been very focused on cost containment and some of the other financial metrics. And the revenue line consistently seems to get overlooked. And so for me, that's, you know, I'm always very focused on that. And the part two of that is that to get to that, you need to be in leadership and using leadership to its best impact. And so for me, there's a correlation between leadership and financial results. And you don't have to have the title of president, CEO, but know what you're a leader of, know how you're leading and having impact. And that's the big opportunity. And I think the other piece to this is that the executive coaching is the way to really get to a change state, because a lot of leadership is soft skills, a lot of selling is soft skills, and the executive coaching gets to that. And I say, you know, because of my background, I bring a very business centricity to a human behaviors profession, and the melding of the two is the impact. So I think the way to get this right is to have that model, that methodology, that a corporation could say, okay, if I buy this program, I know I'm going to get that result. And sometimes if you talk to people who've worked with coaches, they'll say, well, it was a great experience. You know, I loved working. We had really great conversations, but they're not always able to articulate the results. So for me, that's the big thing is to, you know, build it stronger so that the correlation between, you know, the sales and leadership and the results through executive coaching come together.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. Do you have beliefs or attitudes around the role of the CEO in sales? What do you think the role of the CEO is in sales?
Yeah, I think role modeling is very important, and I think sales culture is very important, which means that everybody sells.
Right. Love it.
And so I think part of that is, and maybe they're not direct selling, but what's their language that they, you know, share with their team that then translates into sales conversations that their customers really like. So it's a, you know, trickle up, trickle down effect, and very important. And in all the work that I do, when I work with corporations, there has to be an executive sponsor. Maybe it's not the CEO, but there has to be a more senior person that says, I'm vested. I'm going to work on this too. I'm part of this engagement. And I think that's, you know, that's where the success comes from. So definitely, you know, all leaders, the more connected they are, shared language and focused on sales and revenue, then everybody wins.
Love it. Yeah, that's outstanding. I agree with you 100%. There's a And you and I are going to be working with a group here in Atlantic Canada, where we're trying to influence the culture within Atlantic Canada around sales. And just who are listening, in Atlantic Canada, we face many demographical problems, and a solution to some of these systemic issues that we have is to grow our entrepreneurial community and create business success stories as a means to attract money from outside the region in. And that obviously, involves us as a group becoming better at selling ourselves and our ideas. And one of the members of the group, I'm not sure if you're familiar with the organization Sunny Corner Enterprises, out of Sunny Corner in New Brunswick.
I am familiar. Yes. Okay. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
The owner of that company, and his name escapes me right now, but apparently he has a saying that if you don't work for a salesperson, you are working with the wrong company. So everybody in the organization is should be embracing the role of sales, and obviously to certain different extents, but the theory behind it is we all should be embracing sales, right?
Yeah, I totally agree. And I don't know if you've been following any of the work that Canadian Professional Sales Association is doing, but that's certainly, they're moving the needle on that. One of the projects I worked with them on was actually putting a framework of sales competencies together. So there was a national group of some very high sales focused sales culture organizations, and we all contributed to defining the competencies and the level of competencies for salespeople. And they're now actually working on certification. And I think you and I both know there are many people who say they're salespeople, but when they're actually put in the roles, there are gaps in their skills and their toolbox. So by longer term vision, and what they were CPSA is working on is a designation, so a certified sales profession. So I'm actually writing my exam in August. I'll say it out loud, right? You know what you say happens.
Yeah. I love it.
So I'm working on that certification as part of one of their early adopters, so that again, as part of a very vested sales professional in the industry and in business, the certification and the quality, so that people know that I also have a certain level of skill. Yeah. That when I talk sales, they know that I've got the credentials and the credibility by my own testing, or I shouldn't say by the testing.
By the testing of the certification or the accreditation. Outstanding. This has been a great show. I'm very appreciative of you coming on. What is the best way for individuals listening to get to know you more, follow you, reach out to you, ask you questions? How would you like people to do that?
I love that. Thank you. I'm an active blogger.
Yeah.
So my website, pivotalcoachingservices.com, you'll find my blog, and they're all around leadership, revenue, and results. And the other places, if you like motivational quotes, you'll find me on Instagram as well. So Pivotal Coaching and LinkedIn, definitely. I think anyone who's B2B like you and I, that is a very predominant platform. So very active there as well. So like you, I'm active in promoting. I am very focused on providing my network curated content. So I do thoughtful posts that on articles and information that I have personally screened and read and think my network would read. So yeah, so several there places there. Thank you for that.
PivotalCoachingServices.com.
Correct. Yep.
Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. And I'll make sure. And by the way, that the fact that you're going to do your certification in August is going to be in the show notes. You have to follow through on it now.
Yeah, exactly. A follow up note. Yeah. You're going to hold me accountable, right?
That's right.
I love it. Thank you.
Well, thanks so much for taking the time to be on the show, and look forward to getting feedback from it. I think it's been great. I love the alignment between your message and my message is amazing. And I love to think our conversations further beyond even this show.
Thank you. I had so much fun, such an easy conversation with you. So thank you for the opportunity. Enjoyed it. It was great. And I look forward to the post conversation. I hope the audience weighs in on some of the things we've talked about.
Sounds great. Have a great
one. All right. See ya. Bye.
Thanks for listening to the It's Time to Sell podcast at chrisspurvey.com.